It's good.
Okay, yeah. Good. So first, I apologize for the slide because my computer kind of broke yesterday evening, and I lost my presentation, and I had to put it back together while doing something else all day today. So I'm going to talk about detachment faults and serpentinization at mesosnic ridges in 11 slides. So in the first slide, you see a sample from abyssal pyridotite sample in which you see an important thing is that serpentinization is not homogeneous in the samples that we collect. And here we have a core that is partially serpentinized with a mesh texture, and then serpentinization degrees increases towards these veins that look like veins, but actually there were microfractures that helped fluids circulate. And next to these veins, you have halos of more extensively serpentinized pyridotite. And we believe that this happens a little bit at several scales, like here it's at the centimeter or decimeter scale, but it can also occur probably at hectometric and kilometric scale. And here we have a 3D view of the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. The present day actual valley is an actual valley, and it has a volcanic ridge. So it's not an amagmatic setting, but on one flank of the ridge, you see these structures, these domal structures, and here they are beautifully corrugated. And this is how we interpret them with the detachment faults that exhume these domes, and the geology there is a mixture of partly serpentinized ultramafic rocks and intrusions of gabbros and basalts. Oops, what's going on? Okay, and the first thing that we know is that there is indeed most probably serpentinization down to significant depth. And I said down here, but we will see that it's not necessarily down that it occurred. And that's given to us by geophysical proxies, such as seismic velocity models. And here we have a seismic velocity model that was produced for the area where we drilled pyridotites during ODP, site ODP 920. And so you see that here this line gives you the 8 kilometers per second. So it's the base of the crust. So you do have a crust that is about 3 kilometers thick in this area. This is the seismic profile. Forget about the other things there. And the thing is that it's not only pyridotite that we have there. So we don't really, it's not ready. You cannot readily interpret that into degrees of serpentinization because you also have the gabbros that play a role. And I won't go into details, but it's kind of boringly described in this paper. But depending on the proportion of gabbros, you could have different degrees of serpentinization. And also a very important thing is that at some point, the only way you can interpret the velocities, the very low velocities that you get is to say, okay, it's not just serpentinization, it's obviously also fracturation, etc. So it means that this part, we know it's probably made of serpentine, but it could be made of anything. And it's knowing that it's interesting to look at a place where we know that there is very little gabbro, because we know that our geophysical crust will be indeed made mostly of partially serpentinized or fractured pyridotite. And there is such a place that is beautifully exposed because it's an area where there is very little sedimentation at the eastern end of the Southwest Indian Ridge. And it's an area that in general has a low melt supply, but this melt is focused to volcanoes along the axis. And so it leaves corridors where you had the spreading, the plate divergence was accommodated by successive detachments. And these detachments extended up to almost 100 kilometers along axis. So that's a sketch of the present day detachment is here. And we've been doing some geophysics and some geology in this area. And if I look at the geology, we indeed have pyridotites exposed almost everywhere, except in some places where we have little patches of basalt. And here you can see that these patches of basalt, they're very thin cover, just a few lava flows that cover the ultramafic seafloor. And you have others here. And then when we look at the geophysical proxies for crustal structure or crustal thickness, we see that as in the case of the Atlantic, we do have a geophysically defined crust that is non-negligible. It's actually, depending on if you look at the seismic velocity model, it's up to 5 kilometers thick in this area. And the white line here is the gravity model. So in either cases, it's pretty thick. And also what's interesting is that it has a lot of structure. It has reflectors. These reflectors there are interpreted as the damage of the present day detachment, the active detachment that emerges somewhere here. So it's the other way around. But these other, there are interpreted as small displacement conjugate normal force. And there are also some subhorizontal things that we interpret as magmatic intrusions. They don't represent a large volume, but it's reasonable to think that they are there because we have these basalt patches on the seafloor. And also actually more recently, we've looked at seismicity, active recorded seismicity, and there were some seismicity that really clearly related to a magmatic injection that occurred just right in this area. And so looking at the profiles, so that's a compilation of profiles from mid-oceanic ridges, and that's a compilation of profiles from margins, from where ultramafics are exposed. And we have two profiles here. And one thing that's interesting is it shows probably the role of active fracturation, because the profile in red that corresponds to a crust a little bit away from the axis has faster overall velocities than the profile in blue that's just in the hanging wall just at the axis. And so you have this very regular gradient that's kind of typical of ultramafic crusts everywhere, and can be interpreted as increasing degrees of subatomization. So that's for the geophysical proxies. Now the sampling, the problem with the sampling, I'm sorry, it's a little bit complicated, but the problem with the sampling is that the samples, they come either from directly at the seafloor, the dredges, or from just a few hundred meters at most from the seafloor. And the seafloor is an exhumed fault surface. And in other words, the seafloor samples inform only on serpentinization processes that occur in the detachment fault zone itself or very near to it. While we have from the geophysical proxies, we know that we need to have serpentinization extending down now to 4 kilometers, which may have occurred laterally with distance from the fault zone, but we don't know where it occurred really. And so nonetheless, it's interesting to look at what we have. So these samples, what they show this heterogeneous distribution of serpentinization with a sketch here that based on the dredging results, we can kind of assume that it's not just decimeter scale, but it might be also kilometer scale, places where you do have more serpentinization and places where you have less. It also shows that the most serpentinization, at least this partial serpentinization here, occurs, is allowed by a very, very fine network of microfractures that are probably caused by a combination of tectonic and thermal cracking. And the other thing is, I mean, there are many things that we know about this, but another important thing is that all of this seems to occur at high temperature, at temperatures above 200 degrees, which doesn't necessarily mean that it occurs deep, because it could occur like for at rainbow, for example, if you have hydrothermal fluids that come out at 300 degrees, you might serpentinize at the seafloor at 300 degrees. Okay, so how can you get the foot wall and of course the hanging wall be serpentinized also? Clearly,
tectonic... you have 10 minutes.
Okay, okay. Oh, wow. Clearly, tectonic damage would play a role, and that's something that can be tested. I don't know if there are other. I know there are other models that have done that, but for example, in this model, we assume that serpentinization would occur in rocks that were at the right temperature conditions, not too deep, and that had been deformed to a certain amount. And in this more recent model, it's assumed instantaneous serpentinization associated with a little bit more physical approach, modeling the dilatancy that could be associated with the deformation due to the detachment. And well, maybe that's the last thing I will say, is that another thing is that we know that there are several hydrothermal contexts of serpentinization at source plane ridges. We know that because there are places where you don't have any vents, but you just record diffuse methane venting. And these are very slow fluxes, but everywhere. So it means that it's kind of a slow and homogeneous serpentinization. In some places, probably the same type of system localizes fluid effluents, and you've got these low to moderate fluxes at places like the Lost City hydrothermal site. And then you have places like Rainbow, and when you look, and Rainbow is a serpentinization that is triggered by magmatism. And when you look at the fluxes at Rainbow, you see that Rainbow is currently serpentinizing extremely large volumes of pyrrhotite. So you might just have a few rainbows every 10,000 years, and that would be enough. And so the question is that even at places with very sparse magmatism, you could actually trigger serpentinization with the magmatism. And that's what is kind of sketched here, that even if you have very little magmatism, you could, while the magmatism is occurring, trigger rainbow type circulation that would serpentinize a lot of the rocks in the hanging wall and in the foot wall. And so that's the three takeaways, is that the serpentinization does contribute to the formation of a geophysically defined crust. Maybe I don't have time to read the rest, Chandrato. I can leave the slide.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Mathilde, for this talk. Are there some questions? If you have questions, just type in the chat. In the meantime, I have one question. Actually, how do fluids go down, and where do they go down?
Oops. So if I go back here, the fluids will go down in places where you have permeability, and so you might have permeability because you have tectonic damage, and maybe this would be let's assume that this tectonic model is good. The places in color other than dark blue are places where you have tectonic damage, and so you might have fluids going down. And then the question is how much fluid does go down, and what is the flux? If you have a little bit of magmatic heat, it will enhance the flux. And I don't know if it answers the question.
Yeah, I was just wondering if you have, for instance, the hanging folds in the hanging wall of the detachments that might be pathways that you...
Yeah, for sure. Like in this model, you can see maybe the color range is not very well chosen, but you've got some potential serpentinization occurring here. So if you accumulate this model, if you let the thing go, once it's serpentinized, it's not going to unserpentinize. So it's going to accumulate, and you might end up with a
Are there other questions? Are somebody, if you have a question, just open the microphone and ask. I don't see that there is another question. Well, I have another question, probably the last one, if you do not have a question. What is the rule of the hanging wall? Because you always talk about the foot wall, because you exhume and you probably sample the foot wall. But what is the foot wall also affected by serpentization? Is there a, not the hanging wall, is it affected by serpentization like subduction zones that you, or how do you think that the hanging wall is working while you have this process?
Well, the hanging wall, for sure, in places where you have a mostly peridotite in the hanging wall, also it's being serpentinized. It's even probably the best place to do a lot of serpentinization, because a lot of the magmatism, of the sparse magmatism, gets into the hanging wall, and either into the main fault or into the hanging wall, and also the hanging wall is fractured. You've seen that the seismic velocities are lower, and it has a lot of reflections. So it's a possibility that a lot of serpentinization occurs here.
Okay.